Simon & Schuster Audio presents Forrest Gump, written and read by Winston Groom.
Let me say this. Being an idiot is no box of chocolates. People laugh, treat you shabby. Even so, I got no complaints, because I reckon I done live a pretty interesting life, so to speak. My IQ is near 70, but I'm probably a lot brighter than most folks think. I can think things pretty good, but when I got to try saying them or writing them, it kind of come out like jello or something. My daddy, he got killed just after I was born, so I never known him. He worked down to the docks as a longshoreman, and one day a crane broke and a big netload of bananas fell down on him. I don't care much for bananas myself. My mama, who is a real fine person, got a little pension from the United Fruit people, and she took in boarders, so we got by okay. When I was little, she kept me inside a lot, so as the other kids wouldn't bother me. In the summer, when it was real hot in the afternoons, she used to put me down into the parlor and pull the shade so it was dark and cool, fix me a pitcher of limeade. Then she'd just sit there and talk on and on about nothing in particular, like a person will talk to a dog or a cat. But I liked it, because her voice made me feel real safe and nice. Mama thought it would be good for me to go to the public school, because maybe it would help me to be like everybody else. But after I'd been there a little while, they come and told Mama I oughtn't to be in there. They let me finish out first grade, though. The other kids, they'd never play with me or nothing, excepting to chase me or laugh at me. All except Jenny Curran, who at least didn't run away from me, and sometimes she'd let me walk next to her, going home. But the next year, they put me in another sort of school. And let me tell you, it was weird. They was retards of all kinds, and kids that couldn't even eat or go to the toilet by themselves. I was probably the best of the lot. It wasn't all bad, though. They let us paint with our fingers and make little things, but mostly it was just teaching us how to do stuff like tie up our shoes and not run, or slobber, or holler, and throw shit around. They wasn't no book learning to speak of, except to read street signs and things like men's and ladies. When I got to be 13, some pretty unusual things begun to happen. I grew 6 inches in 6 months, and my mama was all the time having to let out my pants. Also, I commenced to grow out. By the time I was 16, I was 6 feet 6 inches tall and weighed 242 pounds. What happened next caused a real change in my life. One day, I'm on my way home from nut school, and a car stopped alongside of me. This guy called me over and asked my name and if I'd ever played football. I just shook my head. 3 days or so later, they come and they got me out of the nut school. Turns out the guy in the car was the high school football coach. Name of Fellers. It's kind of a long story what all happened next, but anyway, I begun to play football. Coach Fellers and one of his goons helped me out special since I didn't know how to play. We had this thing where you're supposed to block people, but when we tried it a bunch of times, I couldn't remember what I was supposed to do. Then they tried this other thing they called the defense, where they put 3 guys in front of me and I'm supposed to get through them and trap the guy with the football. The first part was easier because I could just shove the other guy's heads down, but they got mad I didn't jump on the ball carrier real vicious-like after I moved the others out of the way. The truth is, I wasn't so much afraid of hurting him as that I was that he'd get mad at me and they'd start chasing me if I wasn't real nice to everybody. Meantime, I got to go to class. They had worked it out so's I had 3 homeroom classes where you just sat and did whatever you wanted. And then 3 other classes where Miss Henderson was teaching me how to read, just the 2 of us. She was real nice and pretty. And more than once or twice, I had nasty thoughts about her. Guess who should be in 1 homeroom class but Jenny Curran. She was all growed up now with pretty black hair, and she was long-legged and had a beautiful face, and they was other things, too, I dare not mention. The football was not going exactly to the liking of Coach Fellas. But one day, an event happened that changed all that. In the cafeteria, I had started sitting next to Jenny Curran. I wouldn't say nothing, but she was just about the only person in the school I knew halfways. And it felt good sitting there with her, even though most of the time she didn't pay me no attention and talked with other people. But after a while, I started to notice this other guy was there a lot, too. And he started making wisecracks about me, shit like, how's Dumbo and all. This gone on for a week or two. Finally, I says, I ain't no Dumbo. And the guy just starts laughing. And Jenny Curran, she say to the guy to keep quiet, but he takes a carton of milk and pours it in my lap, and I jump up and run out, because it scares me. A day or so later, when I was leaving to go to the gym, there he is with a bunch of his friends. I tried to go the other way, but he started pushing me and calling me a stupo and all. Then he hit me in the stomach. It didn't hurt so much, but I was starting to cry, and I begun to run and heard him and the others running after me. I just run as fast as I could across the practice football field, and suddenly I seen Coach Fellas setting up in the bleachers, watching me. The guys who was chasing me stop and go away, and Coach Fellas, he has got this real peculiar look on his face, and he tell me to get suited up right away. A while later, he come in the locker room with three plays drawn on a piece of paper and say for me to memorize them best I can. That afternoon at the football practice, the quarterback give me the ball, and I'm supposed to run outside the right end of the line to the goal post. When they all start chasing me, I run as fast as I can. It was seven or eight of them before they could drag me down. Coach Fellas is mighty happy, jumping up and down and slapping everybody on the back. We'd run a lot of races before to see how fast we could run, but I get a lot faster when I'm being chased. What idiot wouldn't? Anyway, after that, the other guys on the team start being nicer to me. It even got where I liked to run with the football, except mostly they made me run around the sides because I still couldn't just run over people like you do in the middle. I was learning to read a lot better with Miss Henderson. She gave me Tom Sawyer and two other books I can't remember, and I took them home and read them all. But then she gave me a test where I don't do so hot, but I sure enjoyed them books. After a while, I went back to sitting next to Jenny Curran in the cafeteria, and there weren't no more trouble. But then one day, in the springtime, I was walking home, and who should appear but that boy that poured the milk in my lap and chased me that day. Now he got himself a stick and start calling me moron and stupo. Some other people was watching, and then along come Jenny Curran, and I'm about to take off again, but then, for no reason I know, I just didn't do it. That fella take his stick and poke me in the stomach with it. I says to myself, to hell with this. And I grabbed a hold of his arm with one hand, and I knock him upside the head with the other. And that was the end of that, more or less. That night, my mama got a phone call from the boy's parents. Say if I lay a hand on their son again, they's going to call the authorities and have me put away. I tried to explain it to my mama, and she say she understand. But I could tell she was worried. She tell me that since I am so huge now, I got to watch myself, because I might hurt somebody. And I promised her I wouldn't hurt nobody else. But what that did for me, knocking that boy upside the head, put a definite new light on my football plan. Next day, I asked Coach Fellas to let me run the ball straight on. And he say, okay. And I run over maybe four or five guys till I'm in the clear. And then they all had to start chasing me again. That year, I made the All-State football team. My mama saved up and bought me a new suit that I wore to get the award. First suit I ever had. Mama tied my tie for me, and off I went. We was put on a bus. There was five or six of us from this area who won the prize and was trucked up to the All-State football banquet at Flemington. It was an hour or two before we arrived, and the bus didn't have no toilet. And I had drunk two Slurpees before we left, so when we get to Flemington, I got to go real bad. When we get inside the auditorium, me and some of the others find the toilet, but my zipper is stuck in my shirt tail and won't come down. After a bit of this, a nice little guy finds Coach Fellas, and he come in with his two goons, and they be trying to get my pants open, One of the goons say, "Only way to get it down is just rip it apart." At this, Coach Fellows put his hands on his hips. "I suppose you expect me to send this boy out there with his fly unzipped and his thing hanging out. Now, what kind of impression do you think that would make?" Then he turned to me and say, "Forrest, you just got to keep a lid on it till this thing's over, and then we get it open."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.